pretty backlit, so the lighting might not be the best here, but hopefully you can see that Jeremy and I are sitting next to a big culvert on a creek here. Did you say this is Blaney Creek?
This is Blaney Creek, yes.
Okay. So this culvert is kind of an example of a stream crossing that didn't work very well, and when we're doing forestry in the coast, in mountains, in a rainforest, there's lots of streams. There's lots of over-surface flow of precipitation, lots of streams, and so when you're designing logging roads, it's very common that you're going to have stream crossings or water crossings of some sort. So, Jeremy, can you talk a little bit about the history of this culvert and perhaps what went wrong with it?
Certainly. So, this was built in 1971 at a time before we had the practices we do today. And so this is a great example of something we would not do today, and also a good example of something that we can tackle to restore and improve upon, both for safety and road passage for hauling logs and for the environment. This is what we call an elliptical culvert. It's about 4 meters in diameter. And it was put in amongst the native fill, the soils that were already here. And those soils weren't studied prior to the installation like they would be today. Had they been, we would know that we would not want to put those soils back in against the pipe because they don't compact properly.
So when they built this, it might not be clear from the student's perspective. So there's a road up here. So the issue is that a road needed to cross the creek here. And so they laid down this elliptical culvert and then used the soils that were already at the site to fill in over the top of the culvert and then put the road surface on top of that. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct, yeah. They had to cross Blaney Creek here, and that's how they did it at the time. The other key to a culvert like this is proper compaction of the soil that you do put in there. So that's the other way they erred, is that they didn't have enough or adequate compaction of the material around it. So the pipe itself is like a form that allows the soil to compact around it, forming a soil arch. And that arch is what's carrying the load that's being transported over the road.
So the pipe itself is not that strong. It's not the strength of the pipe that's holding the road. The pipe is there to hold the rock and the soil in place. And then that ideally will form an arch that holds the weight as the trucks go over the top. Is that right?
Yes, that's correct. But unfortunately, in this situation, the pipe started to collapse because it was getting specific point loads along that pipe from the soil taking the load from above. And so when
because they didn't compact it well enough.
Because the improper soils, the structural makeup of it, and then the compaction of those soils was not adequate. So the pipe started to collapse on them. So to combat that, they put in a row of columns right down the middle of the pipe. And then that didn't work because the sides started to come in on the sides. So they then put in rods horizontally going across the pipe to push it out and retain it.
And they were trying to brace the culvert from the inside so that it wouldn't collapse.
Yeah. And so what's happened over time is that they, with precipitation and rain and just settling of the material on it, it has actually now become stable. And actually will carry quite the proper load that we want. It has now formed a soil arch, but in the process, it has damaged the stream. The culvert itself has changed the dynamics of this stream. It's accelerated the water out the other end and created a plunge pool, and this structure now itself has become a barrier to fish.
Can you explain what a plunge pool is?
So when the water comes through the stream here, the stream has a certain width, and the water can kind of stay at a certain depth over a certain width in the stream, and then it gets confined as it comes into the culvert. And as you do that with water, it actually increases in speed. And so what happens is the water is accelerating now through the pipe, which is also a smoother bottom with less resistance. And then as it comes out, it now comes out into a wider expanse and suddenly slows down and drops. And that slowing and dropping of the water is hammering the bottom of the stream and then eroding and scouring out the outflow point of this pipe.
Which the water as it comes out of the pipe is kind of making a waterfall, and it's coming out with good velocity, but going essentially straight down. And so it's eroding and washing away the soil and the rock, the substrate that was under there, and also eroding some of the structures under the end of the culvert as well.
Yes, yeah. So when the culvert was put in, it was put in at the elevation of the stream bed itself. And then through just the acceleration of water and then slowing down, it's created this erosional effect that is now scoured down about 12 feet down, and then it started to migrate underneath the pipe itself as well as the sides. So if you note the width on this side and compare it to the other side is about four times wider than this side. And you can see the active scouring of the sides and the widening at the outflow.
So on this side, the water level is basically at the culvert. But on the other side, now the water comes out of the culvert and immediately drops down. How does that impact the movement of fish through the stream now?
So in this, it depends on the fish. So in this stream, we know we have cutthroat and we have dolly varden species. And they have their own unique abilities in what they can travel and withstand, the grades they can climb, and the habitat they need to rear in. And so what's happened is that they're not able to physically make the jump into the pipe and overcome the velocity to get to this side here. So what you have is populations that are born up here that end up moving down the stream, and if they pass through the pipe, they cannot return. So there are isolated populations on that side.
So with this culvert, initially it was a structural problem, and that kind of resolved itself over time as that soil finally compacted just roads, and they were able to reinforce the culvert. So the culvert structurally is okay now. So now you're dealing more with the ecological problem, that this has become a barrier where fish can go in that direction, but once they've passed the other end of the culvert, it's very difficult for them to move back in this way.
Yes,
and so that's motivated you to replace this culvert. Can you talk about what your plan is now to replace this?
So we replace this as if this was never put in here. So when we look at this stream, we don't look at the stream near the pipe because this has changed the dynamics of the stream so much that we don't want to plan for what we see here.
So you don't think that what we see here is not a good representation of what the stream should look like?
That's right, yeah. So we're going to travel further upstream and much further downstream, and then take some averages and rebuild in our mind what this middle section that the pipe is in would look like. And then we're going to plan and build to that. And in today's world, when we cross a stream like this with these two fish species in it, we know that we can only build in the month of August. So we are tackling that this year and building the span over this. The other thing too is we're not allowed to build a pipe in a stream like this with fish. We have to cross it with what we call a clear span. So a span that bridges both sides of the creek, has its own foundation that it sits on, and then does not have anything in the middle, allowing the stream to pass naturally underneath the structure itself.
So you're going to remove the culvert and put in a bridge, so that rather than the stream flowing through a culvert, you're going to try to restore a more natural surface or more natural substrate in the stream, and then just have a bridge that's going across it.
Yes, that's correct, yes. And then as part of that restoration process too, we have this step gradient at the end. And so we have this significant elevation drop as we travel through the system. So another phase of this is to put in some steps barriers, some coarse wood into the stream to help retain some of the stream bed that's existing, so that it just does become a flat slope coming through here. And so we're going to use a mix of large diameter cedar logs and large diameter rock to pin and build a step system coming down. The pool at the end that's formed is actually a habitat feature that fish like. They can survive the hotter times of summer when water levels are low in the stream. They can have shelter there from prey. So there's a lot of benefits to us. So rather than filling that in and going to the work and ethic effort of doing that, we're going to actually try and preserve that feature, but allow enough gradient, a gentle enough gradient coming out of that pool into the existing natural stream bed here on this side that fish can pass, and this is no longer a barrier.
So you said based on the maybe the size of the creek and the fish species that are present here, you would not put a culvert in. Is that kind of a Malcolm Knapp decision, or are there some regulations about that?
Yes, there's practice regulations that forbid and govern this kind of situation. And it starts with identifying the size of your stream and the type of fish you have in it. And so we work here out of a book called the Riparian Classification System. And from there, we denote an S designation. And in this, if you were to look up into that book, this creek would be an S3. A creek of a certain width with fish presence in it. And then according to each of those S classes within that, you have certain permissible things you're allowed to do, whether it be crossing it or harvesting up to a creek like this.
So what other types of, so we have a culvert here, you're putting in, I would call it a bridge. What did you call it? A bridging span?
A clear span bridge.
Clear span
structure.
What are some other types of stream crossings that might be put in for varying classes of streams?
So typically it would be a clear span, and how you build that clear span can vary a lot. There are multi-plate systems you can use that have natural bottoms to them. So they're arch systems like this, and then they anchor into the ground into footings themselves. The important thing to note when you're designing and working around a stream like this is what the natural erosion process is like. And there's a process called scour, and we need to determine to what level the stream naturally scours to. And then we want to find that elevation in the creek, and then we want to go quite a ways below that. So that as the stream bed moves material and naturally, dynamically changes and picks up material and drops material, that is not going to work its way underneath our footing structure for anything that we build in this. So for a stream like this, we want a system that allows a natural bottom. So
that, you say a natural bottom. In this case, the water flows over a culvert, so it isn't a natural bottom. So you're saying that the bottom where the water is flowing over should be natural stone or whatever the substrate is that is in the crest.
Yeah, so that can be a concrete C-shaped kind of box that sits down. It can be an embedded culvert that goes down into the creek, and then you fill it with a bed material from the creek that goes through it. And then it can be a full-size clear span bridge. All of these have cost implications and lifespan implications and loading implications, what they can carry over them. So knowing what your limitations are in budget and what you want to do with the road, what you want to carry on the road, is very important.
I would imagine putting in a clear span bridge is probably quite expensive.
Yes, this one is about $200,000 to build, and we built a used structure to put on this. So that's $200,000 with the used structure, maybe $250,000 if we went with the new structure. In this province, we don't own the water. So wherever you're working in forestry, you have to take that into consideration. And so whenever you're going to do work in a stream or near a stream like this kind of project, you have to apply for permission to do that with governing bodies. And there's a survey that's required, there's an understanding of the fish presence, the stream dynamics. You make that application with them. And then once you're registered and given permission, then you can conduct a project like this in a safe work window. And that safe work window is determined purely by the fish species present in the creek.